There's something a little off with Brie Larson's performance in this movie, and I couldn't quite put my finger on it while I was watching the film. I was like, I should like this. The lines are funny, but there's just something lost in the performance. And then I was talking to someone after the screening, and it hit me. She's trying to do a Robert Downey Jr. impression. And I don't think it was her idea, to be fair. But when she's not trying to be Robert Downey Jr., I would say that Brie Larson's Captain Marvel is actually quite compelling. And I think if Marvel lets her do her own thing and make the character her own going forward, well then, I think she could be a pretty exciting addition, not just to the MCU, but the overall superhero movie landscape. In fact, I would equate her performance here with the two Chrises, who, as you might recall, each needed a couple of movies to get their footing, but now they're both magic. We can't imagine anyone else in the roles. And I see, I think, very possibly a similar future for Brie Larson as Captain Marvel. Robert Downey Jr., though, is pretty damn special. Perfect from the get-go. And I suppose, as Marvel tries to replace their original trilogy going forward with a new roster, of course they'd want to try and, you know, of course they'd want to keep it. I mean, I don't know. I don't know if they should blatantly copy the trilogy, you know, the Trinity's personas so much. But I have to say, I do think it's nice that they feel that a woman could duplicate the Stark sass. But it's not Brie Larson. I think Emily Blunt could do it. And to Brie Larson's credit, I don't even think Charlize Theron could do it. Maybe like a younger Allison Janney could do it very well. But again, Brie Larson, while very game, she tries very, very hard to deliver, I think, what is asked of her. She just ain't a comedic actress. And that's why it's the quiet moments where Carol lets her guard down that Larson handles with the skill of an Oscar winner. You can see her talent come through in spades. It's like the moment, for instance, that everyone loves so much when she screams at a Skrull, right? It seemed very cute and playful in the ad. Well, in the context of the story here, it just doesn't work. And we'll talk about Carol not taking her opponents very seriously in just a moment, because the film is a mixed bag, and that's one of the problems. But I want to first say that the most impressive thing about Brie Larson's Captain Marvel is her self-confidence and matter-of-factness. She does not hesitate, and I love that about her. As female characters so often do hesitate in entertainment. Even Wonder Woman does. Like, Wonder Woman hesitates a lot. Carol Danvers, though, is simply competent. More than competent, she's damn good at her job. She knows what she needs to know. And I felt she never really showed off either, which I appreciated. She just, you know, again, she's self-confident because she knows that she knows what she's doing, and she just goes for it and has a matter of factness. Sometimes it gets her into trouble. But I think that is in line with that character trait, and I thought it was handled very well. And Maria Rambeau comes across in a similar fashion, and it's pretty darn exciting to watch. She is also, though, unfortunately, Captain Marvel, quite the Mary Sue. Not only ridiculously overpowered, but like Rey, able to instantly harness and excel in her newfound powers. It's equally ridiculous, just like when you watch that end battle, that third act battle in The Force Awakens. I will say, though, that Larson has a similar, likable, every woman quality to her, just as Daisy Ridley does, and I think Daisy Ridley did a lot to make Rey likable despite some story elements there. And also, Brie Larson benefits from being in a much better and far more interesting movie, which we'll also discuss more in a moment. But as I said, the third act does suffer significantly from Carol not taking her opponents or the threat seriously. Even Robert Downey Jr. lets you see him sweat. In fact, he lets you see him sweat quite a lot. It's very compelling. And as a result, during the final battle here, you could hear, it was fascinating, you could hear a pin drop in the theater. Absolute silence. But it's not because people were in awe. It's because I think it's two-pronged. On one hand, it's like it's very by the numbers. It has a detached quality to it. And also, I think there's just so much riding on this movie from like a representation standpoint. And there's been so much anger and heated discussion over it that I think the movie does have to fight that, and that you look at it with a very analytical approach. And although, you know, I think the movie, if it was maybe a little less Marvel formulaic, I don't know if I want to put that label on it so much, but I think that if Marvel took more risks, maybe it could have overcome that analytical approach because with emotion. But it's weird because the movie talks so much about Captain Marvel not being able to control her emotions, which is interesting because women are often accused of being so emotional. And I had no problem with that. I thought that was good, actually. But it's weird that the movie is somewhat devoid of emotion. but as a movie, Captain Marvel has a lot of boxes to check. Like, for instance, I'm talking about in terms of, like, representation and that kind of stuff. And also, where the Avengers name comes from will make even a number of feminists roll their eyes. It's too much, Feige. It's just a step too far. But at the same time, the movie checks very few boxes that fans want to see checked. For instance, nothing is set in motion for Phase 4. Again, Marvel doesn't like to take risks. Kevin Feige doesn't like to take risks. I think that's a huge missed opportunity. There are no big reveals. There are no real surprises either. You've guessed most of it from the trailers. There were two surprises, though. Two genuine surprises. One that made me gasp for real. I was very impressed with it. And one that made me think. And I think that I would have probably even liked that surprise more if the movie had spent more time on it. I mean, I like the way the movie is. Maybe if I had another half hour or so, I think maybe it would have been even better. So honestly, and I'm sad to say this because I know a lot of you don't want to see this movie. You don't have to see Captain Marvel in terms of the bigger MCU picture. Even the end credit scenes, I wouldn't say they're weak. One of them's actually pretty darn exciting, but they don't give any information really. It's basically, I won't spoil it, but it's soft, let's say. But I think that thanks largely to writer-directors Anna Boden and Ryan Fleck, also Geneva Robertson-Durrett is a writer as well, there are enough quirky, interesting moments and some very strong female characters, very strong, to make the movie still worth your time, especially if you're into the advancement of female characters in blockbuster movies. There's something interesting happening here, for sure, even if it is half-baked. Also, while it's been done many, many times before, Carol figuring out her backstory is done in a pretty interesting way, especially with some nice sci-fi twists. I like the way they handled that. Also, there's a vintage quality to the movie, besides the fact that it just takes place in the 90s, but it feels like those classic blockbusters, from the action scenes in the first two-thirds, to the cinematography, to the score. I'm not talking about the soundtrack, the music, like the song selection. I'm talking about the actual score, which has a John Williams-esque quality to it. Low-key, but it's there. And it gives it a fun nostalgic feel at points, even if the movie can't maintain it. But the supporting cast is amazing, so good. All right, Samuel L. Jackson's Fury graduates quite smoothly from extended cameos to, I would say, full-on lead. And while Clark Gregg's Coulson is used very sparingly, he still knows how to make an impression. I think they actually could have done more with Coulson. Goose the Cat has been getting a lot of attention, but I have to say, Samuel L. Jackson is the one that makes that whole cat storyline work. So he does a lot of work here. Lashana Lynch, a last-minute replacement, is so strong when she shows up halfway through the movie that it actually catches you off guard. You're like, wow, she's doing some serious acting right now. And Akira Akbar sets the bar awfully high for whichever actress gets to play Monica Rambeau as an adult. I think that role, if it already wasn't a must-get for a lot of actresses in Hollywood, it certainly will be after everyone sees Akira Akbar's performance. As for the Kree, they don't get a lot of screen time. Jude Law is pretty much playing Jude Law with special contacts in. And Gemma Chan is given nothing to do. It's very much like, no, future movie, she's going to... I mean, you only would know that if you were familiar with the comics. But she's just there as a seed to plant. But not in a very compelling way. But without giving anything away, keep an eye on Annette Bening. Oh, we'll be talking about her in the spoiler review. And then, of course, there's Mr. Ben Mendelsohn. Just when I think I'm tired of his shtick, he goes and turns his shtick up to an 11. Wow. Now, I think that the praise for his work kind of gives away the twist. But I can tell you that there is no way that you are truly prepared for how good he is in this movie and how well his role is written. Loved it. So, yeah, this is kind of Captain Feminism, the movie. But there's enough good stuff here, enough potential, that I'm not only okay with that, but I actually think it's kind of cool. So that's my review of Captain Marvel. I'm very curious to hear your thoughts down below. Save the spoiler comments if you've seen it for the spoiler review, which will be coming soon. And then, of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.